Parental discretion is advised.
Find yourself in the Beachview area of Pittsburgh? Check out the official pizza of this show, Slice on Broadway, sharing an abnormal obsession with pizza we can relate to. Check them out at sliceonbroadway.com and tell them this show sent you. Hey guys, it's the Wrestling Mayhem Show. Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitter here in Pittsburgh, PA, and Mayhem Central, celebrating 10 years this week. We'll talk about that here a little bit later in the show. This is your show where we're talking about professionalized wrestling, the John Cena's, okay, whenever he's actually not injured, and all those kinds of guys in WWE, the big time wrestling. With me, as usual, also here in the Pittsburgh area, it is your Papa Lunchbox, DJ Lunchbox, joining us. How you doing? And I like your picture of the cat in the background on the video feed.
Thank you very much. Apparently there was cats in the background of every episode tonight, all the different shows you recorded, so I added one right there. It is actually the dried blood of seven squirrels that I sacrificed to the podcast gods tonight, so it should be a good show.
Awesome, awesome. And it's a big show. We got a lot of great, great guests here, getting some different inputs. Like I said, the new year, I wanted to get a lot of different people on this show. And we got a lot of them just tonight, so I kind of overcompensated a little bit. First of all, joining us, I think the first time on the Wrestling Mayhem Show, but there's a great interview we did with him back on the Indie Mayhem Show sometime last year, I think. Justin LaBar of Chairshot Reality and WrestleZone.com and manager to the stars in the International Wrestling Cartel. How you doing tonight, Justin?
It's nice to take a break from not managing the stars and talk to everybody else. Thanks for having me on.
Thanks so much for joining us. We're going to get into a lot of stuff with him tonight. And also joining us here, special guests for the first segment. We got to squeeze them in. They got a lot of stuff going on up there in Poughkeepsie, New York. For once, I'm introducing people from Poughkeepsie, New York, that to my knowledge don't have a future endeavor letter from the WWE like our usual co-hosts. So thank you. Join us, Steve and John from AnotherWrestlingPodcast.com. I've been enjoying the show. Guys, I caught on to you guys a few weeks ago. I sit down there during Raw and kind of going at it and commenting and seeing who else pops up. And you guys have been another one that I kind of followed along with. And I'm digging this stuff on there. Thank you so much for joining me.
Hey, no problem. Thanks for having us.
Awesome.
Glad to be here.
Awesome. So, first of all, I want to touch base. You guys have something pretty cool going on up there. Our other Mad Mike, of course, a regular on this show for several years, is from the Poughkeepsie area. And I know you guys have some connections and you're doing some stuff with Global Force Wrestling that I think is pretty cool for a podcast to be doing this. Can you give us a real quick kind of rundown of what's happening there?
Yeah, sure. We're working with Global Force Wrestling. They're going to be here January 22nd in Poughkeepsie. We will be doing a special Q&A for the VIP before the show. Basically, we're going to have kind of like a live question and answer with the superstars and anybody who comes out and purchases a VIP ticket. Right, Jonathan?
Yeah, absolutely. And you'll get to not only hear us talk to the wrestlers, but you'll get to meet Karen Jarrett, Jeff Jarrett. A lot of the wrestlers are going to be there live, you know, taking pictures and signing autographs with everybody. So it's definitely cool. We've got to have a lot of them on the show in recent weeks. So it looks like it's going to be a great weekend, the first tour of Global Force in the Northeast.
Awesome. Awesome. And of course, some connections there with Pro Wrestling Syndicate. Got to see one of their shows. It was actually the place where we first sold the Montreal Theory documentary with that I did with Joe Dombrowski several years ago, our first kind of big production out of here. And it's a really cool show, and it's cool to see them kind of mixing up with Global Force. It's kind of cool to see a wrestling podcast getting involved with a local show like that. It's kind of fun to hear what you guys have going on. I can't wait to hear kind of how it goes with you guys as it comes up here. So, and hopefully Matt and Mike will say hi to you if he gets up there as well. So, like I said, guys, please check out everything going on at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. You subscribe to this. And so many other shows that we're doing. We're doing wraps of shows throughout the week. Raw, Lucha Underground, when that comes back. TNA Impact, which is actually probably going on right now as we speak, I guess, during this recording live. Tuesday nights, live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com. You can join us in the chat room, just like our good friends Bobby F. J-Town, Eamon from down in Texas. Wife of the show, Missy, is in there helping us out. And a whole bunch of new names. Tragar, love his blog. And everybody else. And of course, please drop us a line, 412-206-WMS0. I got to fix those graphics. Good times. I guess only one here has the cue.
Good time.
There he is. He knows it. Good times at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. And, of course, big thanks to our friends on the Patreon. They're supporting the show. Ed Burke, the Jennifer and Matt Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment. And, of course, from the WrestlingRevolution.com, Mr. Antonio Garza. And because he pays me on Patreon to say it this way, Bo Diggity! Woo! And I realize we only have one person with all the cues here, so apologies. But no, go patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. You can support the show with your monetary dollars, especially if you win the Powerball here coming up, as some people have already pledged that they're going to. You get some special stuff, some special gold, some state of the show information, and some other stuff we're working on here in the near future. And if you don't want to give a couple bucks, that's fine. Just share the show, leave a comment on iTunes, and everything else. Guys, so I got this big panel here. It seems that, and I know you guys have been discussing this to a certain regard on your own shows, but I kind of wanted to get the brain trust together and talk about a several folds of this. You know, John Cena is just a recent victim of injury. After coming back, he lasted, a whole 2 weeks? We got this supposed signing. The big news today, Nakamura was being stripped of the New Japan Intercontinental Championship, was a pretty decent sign that something's going on around there, and some signings with WWE. WrestleMania is a huge question mark when it comes to a lot of people going on, and what's going to come up with that. The Rock's coming back. Where are we at with this? You know, what do you guys think? How do you feel going into WrestleMania and Raw? I mean, this is usually when we're getting excited about the WrestleMania season, right? Are we worried about WrestleMania?
I'll just start out. I'm not necessarily so worried about WrestleMania. Everybody talks about the brass ring in the WWE or in the world of professional wrestling, and what better time than some of these people that we've all been rooting for to come up and kind of rise to the top. Everybody talks about Kevin Owens. Everybody talks about Ambrose. I mean, there's a lot of people out there that can now kind of shine. And so with some of these people, you hate to see any injury and you hate to see anybody lose their spot. But with the possibility of new signees and with the possibility of, no one coming back before WrestleMania, I think it's a great time to be a wrestler and a wrestling fan, because it's going to shake up WrestleMania like it's never been done before.
Mm-hmm. I mean, isn't that the big thing? Like we thinking back to even late Attitude Era, it was Stone Cold leaving that led to guys like Mick Foley and The Rock stepping up to become huge stars, right? Would Seth have been in the spot he was if people weren't kind of coming and going as they were in this past year as well? I mean, it feels like, given the choice, they're going the safe bets. But it really, do you blame them at this point? Is it complacency as far as the booking side goes? Or there's too much at stake because the company's so big right now? What do you think, Justin?
Well, I don't think there's a complacency necessarily. I think what they've wanted for a long time, which is Roman Reigns to be supported as the next big mainstream appealing babyface, is happening. It's happening. It's proving that you put Vince and Triple H, people that can generate legitimate heat, both from the audience that's in the arena and the internet audience, because of their real life executive positions. It's helping support Roman Reigns, and that's great, because they need that right now more than ever with the injuries that are happening to Cena and Orton and Rollins. I don't think it's a complacency. I think actually this is the first time, being 2 weeks out from Rumble in quite a while, that we have a real refreshing excitement. You can try to map out what the WrestleMania card's going to be, and there's a lot of pieces that are hard to move. You have the wild card of The Rock, who's going to be there, but I don't think is going to wrestle, but that's to be determined. The Undertaker, of course, is a wild card because the streak is no longer intact, but he looks better than he has the last few years, so you figure he's going to work. Then you have Roman Reigns and how that plays out with the Rumble. You have the wild cards such as Daniel Bryan, which I keep telling people not to get so hung up on because that's just going to get their hopes up and crash. Then you have Brock Lesnar, you have Kevin Owens, you have Bray Wyatt. It's really hard to predict this, and that's a good thing. People have bitched about the lack of tradition that's going to be at this year's Royal Rumble, and I say screw that because the last couple of years where we did tradition, where the guy beat the 30 other people to become the number one contender, well, they'll Roman Reigns, it didn't work out so well, and they changed plans. And 2 years ago here in Pittsburgh, Batista didn't work out so well. So I think this is good for them to do something unique like this. And really, not only does it provide unpredictability for all of us talking about this, but it also gives them time right up until January 24th to creatively decide what they want to do.
I tell you what, I've been throwing on some random Royal Rumbles. Of course, after the announcement, I had to throw in the Ric Flair one from 1992. Seemed to make sense. It still holds up. And I threw up one that I was at a few years ago, going to the one in 2008 in Madison Square Garden. And a lot of us from the Mayhem crew went up there for that one. And I remember, how that came out. John Cena was the surprise entrant at the end. And seeing the feel, and I was actually watching all the way up to pretty much the beginning of the Rumble and watching, kind of the build of the people. And you never know. And I guess they still had the brand split, three-way brand split with ECW at the time. Way too many deaths at ringside, by the way. It does kind of have that feeling a little bit. You kind of waver between like, oh, of course Roman's going to come away with this, and we just kind of know that. Versus, I think they have some extra elements with, all these factions. We're making the joke on the Raw wrap ups and the Hangouts lately. It feels like they planned for Survivor Series 3 months too late lately, which means I can't wait for the Rumble throwdowns right before WrestleMania that we're going to see in about 3 months. I think
more accurately is somebody recently introduced Vince McMahon to Game of Thrones, and he's now convinced that everybody must be in that situation.
Cena Collective. Ugh.
Hey, introducing Vince to anything new is going to be an upgrade.
There you go.
I heard he just discovered who Motorhead was, and Lemmy's going to be in the celeb wing of the Hall of Fame, much to the disdain of Triple H for 10 years trying to get pops to listen to Motorhead, but.
We'll talk about the Hall of Fame here coming up here. What about you, Steve? What do you think about going into Rumble, going into Mania, going into this potential drought of at least the top tier dependable talent?
Yeah, I mean, one side, it's great because it just makes people want to watch the Rumble only for that unpredictability. I mean, last year going into the Rumble, we were all like, is it really going to be Roman Reigns? Now we have him as the champion and everybody going after his championship. It's leaving that room for who's going to be the surprise entrance, who's going to be number 30, who's going to be, what's going to happen with it? Are we going to get AJ Styles in there? Is that going to happen sooner than later? Making all these injuries and everybody out, I think, is making the Rumble more appealing to where, it's that anything can happen this year. It truly is, and like Jonathan said and everybody else said, guys are stepping up. Kevin Owens is going to step up. Dean Ambrose is going to step up. You're going to see these guys put on one hell of a show at WrestleMania with all these injuries. And I think they're going to finally get the deserved spotlight to shine at a top show like this. So going into the Rumble, going into Mania, all these injuries that are happening, you have a huge roster, man. You have a lot of talent. So hopefully we see that talent, rise to the occasion and do what they do. And show the world why they are in the top company that they are. So,
right, because it really has been. It's amazing how little it feels like the landscape has changed the last several years, doesn't it? Unless something major like a CM Punk walking away, or somebody getting so injured they have to leave like an edge. Well,
yeah, even look at the last year's winners of WrestleMania. Pretty much all the winners that happened are off and out injured, from Cena to Rollins to Cesaro to, Tyson Kidd, and so on. Pretty much almost all of WrestleMania's card last year is pretty much on the disabled list, if you will. So it's amazing what can happen in the year, and, we'll see what happens, I guess.
And even everybody, looking at, I feel like SmackDown I'm watching from NXT from 6 months ago at this point. Which is, for me, out of the non-NXT shows, has been the most enjoyable show for me. One, I also pay for Hulu Plus, so I don't get any commercials, so that's kind of nice. But it ends with a main event of like Dean Ambrose and Kevin Owens, which is at least quasi entertaining every time that they go out there and beat each other up, right? That's the kind of thing that's of course going to be even bigger. I mean, look what you know, the former Samurai Del Sol that we saw locally here in Pittsburgh, now Kalisto, look what he did on a grand stage when he had a three-way ladder match that last pay-per-view. And now he's the U.S. champion, you know. Definitely a lot of guys finding those opportunities. It's just so hard week in week, that slog on Raw. And then, you know, getting to that pay-per-view to see them kind of stick out a little bit at this point. So are we concerned? Is this, you know, last year WrestleMania reported, I think, the most views. It was the most viewed WrestleMania with, I think, I don't know if anybody remembers the numbers better than this, but over 1 million people watched it. Big thanks to WWE Network. Do you think that number's in danger with the lack of John Cena's and such on this? Or you think everybody's going to be hanging out anyways?
It's one of those things. It's WrestleMania, and that's one thing that WWE has going for them. That brand, that name, WrestleMania, I don't think that it's in danger. I think that a lot of people are going to tune in to see what is going to happen. We've talked about it a lot, the unpredictability. I feel like that's one of the drawing factors this year for WrestleMania. You know, this past Monday, you mentioned Kalisto won the United States Championship. You don't think that that's going to get more people to watch Raw next week just to see what's going to happen? I mean, it's these sort of things that really are going to help with WrestleMania this year. And obviously, throwing The Rock in is not going to hurt, and the possibility of The Undertaker and any of these bigger names coming there, it won't hurt for sure. But WWE's WrestleMania, it's just like the Super Bowl or anything like that. I feel like most people watch these big events no matter what, and to do WWE's credit, they try their hardest to put on an amazing show at WrestleMania, but I don't think it's going to get hurt at all.
I think you'll appreciate this here, LaBar. This could be Plumber Mania takes over WrestleMania with as many people as we've seen in the indies in recent years popping up these days. So,
well, don't feed his ego. I refuse to believe he has anything to do with it. But I am happy with Kalisto and many of the other former IWC guys. Look, as previously stated, which is correct, you know, WrestleMania sells itself, hence why tickets get sold out in a matter of moments in November when no real main event has even been announced, because the name is the draw itself. However, there's a difference between selling, you know, 80,000 worth of tickets and fudging whatever PR phrase you need to fudge. There's a difference between that and ultimately when they add all the seats they need to add after production and all the hoopla, getting the attendance record of, you know, 100,000 or whatever they're aiming for. I think it really boils down to The Undertaker, because you're in Dallas, you're in Cowboys Stadium. Stone Cold Steve Austin's not coming back to have a match. He'll be there, but he's not having a match. CM Punk is not coming back to have a match. Even if The Rock has a match, which I'll get to in a second, that's great, but it's not exactly the first time ever. We've seen him, you know, he was the WWE champion, for Christ's sake, a few years ago. It's going to come down to The Undertaker, and my belief is, if you want to surefire make this standing room only, and I've been to the stadium, I covered a Super Bowl at the stadium, this place is huge. It lives up to its magnitude. If you want to sell this, if you want to get the maximum, it comes down to The Undertaker's career having to be on the line, because, and obviously I'm not here trying to push the legend out the door, especially because he's looked better this past year than he has in previous years where he was remnants of Uncle Festus. But I will say, if you bill it as this guy is having his last match, whether he says it's his last match or whether the stipulation is if he loses it's his last match, that then lets everybody know, I need to pay attention, this is history. And at that point, it doesn't matter whether he's going against a mop or whether he's going against Bray Wyatt or going against Kevin Owens or going against The Rock or any other name that we could put out there. If The Undertaker's last match is what's dangled on this, everything else will fall into place. Triple H is champion. Ronda Rousey and The Rock and Roman Reigns' corner. And anything else we can conceivably, realistically dream of, it starts with The Undertaker.
Right, right. All right, a couple of you guys got to get out of here. So real quick, I don't want to step on a big question or Mayhem Mania for later in the show, but if you could pick a dream a plausible show stealer for WrestleMania at this point as things stand, who would it be? First, you guys from another wrestling podcast.
Ooh, a show stealer for WrestleMania?
Mm-hmm.
Ah, man. Trying to think ahead. I'm trying to think who will be there, what's going to happen. It goes back to the injuries, man. You know, a lot of people are out. A lot of people are going to step up, and a lot of people are going to do a lot of things this year just to keep at that number one spot. And, man, show stealer. I don't know. I'm going to have to say anything. Any match with Kevin Owens this year is going to be a great one. Show stealer, maybe. I don't know. It depends on who he's facing. But I think we're going to see something unique from him this year at WrestleMania. It's going to be his first WrestleMania. It's going to be a big one. So hopefully he goes out in style.
Awesome. What about you, John?
You know, this one's probably not going to be popular, but I really believe that Roman is trying to come into his own. I think that he's came light years from where he was in the Royal Rumble last year. I believe that a Triple H versus Roman Reigns match does have the potential to be something special. And with, you know, if they start the build up soon and if they get some good stuff behind it, I definitely think that it has the potential to be really good at WrestleMania.
LB, do you got something?
Well, I feel like there was a time when if your roster had issues like this, the solution was put the belt on Edge, but there's no more Edge. So this year at WrestleMania, we will see the return of Edge.
What about you, Justin?
Well, in addition to what I said with The Undertaker and his power, I think, as said, I think Triple H versus Roman Reigns for the title is very possible. And I think Triple H as the champion going into Mania, while I have some you know, negatives to it, I can also see a lot of positives. I think if you can build to the mainstream, Triple H, who a lot of people know, who's the executive in WWE, which draws heat, Triple H is the champion versus Roman Reigns. If Triple H has in his corner, and you build it as a real fight, you give it that real fight feel, and you have Triple H with Stephanie McMahon and Vince McMahon in his corner, and then with Roman Reigns, if he has The Rock and Ronda Rousey in his corner, you get mainstream appeal, you play off last year's segment, which was so highly touted at WrestleMania. I think that is something to where it puts nobody at risk, doesn't put The Rock at risk with the movie studios, doesn't put Ronda Rousey at risk with her MMA career and such have. But it's just having their appearance, and even if they just do one spot, Rousey shoots Stephanie to the ground or shoots Triple H to the ground, and same thing with The Rock, you've got some magic there.
I'm going to go, and I don't know how they get there from this point, but give me Ambrose and Lesnar. I think could be interesting, and could be a step up for Ambrose and kind of put him on the map there, and we know how brutal Brock can get. So I think they could have a lot of fun with that. You know, I kind of go back to like the first match. I think it was the first match back with Cena where they just got crazy brutal and steel steps were involved and everything. I could see them in that kind of match, but that's my thoughts. Guys, thank you so much. Another wrestling podcast is the show. Thank you for dropping in here for this first segment and being part of the conversation with us. Anything you guys have other, you know, of course, Global Force Wrestling coming up, anything coming up on your show or anybody should check out over there?
Yeah, guys, thanks so much for having us on tonight. We'd love to do it again in the future. Great talking with all you guys. You know, yeah, check out anotherwrestlingpodcast.com. We're going to have Mickey James and Kimberly on this week. Still talking about Global Force Wrestling happening next week in Poughkeepsie, our hometown. So just stay tuned. And I don't know, anything else? Did I miss anything, Jonathan?
No, that's pretty much it. Just anotherwrestlingpodcast.com. You can follow us at @awrestlingpod on Twitter.
Thanks so much to those guys, anotherwrestlingpodcast.com. But hey, if you want to check out wrestling of another variety, check out, of course, our sister site over at indiewrestling.us. There's a lot of great stuff over there. Including, hey, you can see a lot of Justin LaBar going on over there, right? You can see, Justin, maybe I'll let you sell this a little bit here. I mean, you pretty much your entire illustrious IWC wrestling managerial and actually wrestling career, now I think about it, is encompassed on this site, right?
I think so. I think it is the unofficial archive of Justin LaBar. Probably me getting my ass kicked is more colorfully to describe everything. But yeah, it's there, whether it's with Rhino or Tommy Dreamer or Matt Hardy or blah, 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 blah. It's there. But great, great, great action. Aside from me, I'm probably, the filler. It's great action from a lot of other guys, whether it be Dalton Castle, ROH fame right now, or Matt Stryker or anybody. There's a lot of great stuff that's archived there. So I try to plug it when I can. Definitely if people support indie wrestling, a lot of great stuff coming out of Pittsburgh.
Awesome. Yeah, great stuff there. Like I said, mostly Pittsburgh-based with the IWC and some other friends as well. But we do have stuff like Border City Wrestling up in Canada, and of course some old school stuff. More of your archive. A little bit of Prime Wrestling is up here as well. The old Resolutions and some best ofs of some great guys like somebody named Johnny Gargano. I think they call him Johnny Wrestling out there on the internets. Might be on NXT every once in a while. Greg Irons and a bunch of awesome guys. We like to play a little game a lot of times when we're watching Raw and sometimes, like, Kalisto won, and of course the U.S. title the other night, and of course he used to be, if you look on his Wikipedia, you understand that he's used to be called Samurai del Sol, and we have no less than three events actually on here with him against somebody named El Generico. Seems familiar to somebody in NXT. There's another match with him taking on Colin Delaney, Logan Shulo, who looks kind of like that Drifter guy, and Johnny Gargano in that match as well. A lot of fun stuff in there. And you poke around there, you see what names will pop up. The Corey Graves used to be Sterling James Keenan. A lot of stuff with that guy on here as well, from a couple of different promotions, actually. So check it out. Great column. If you want to know what the indies are about, haven't dived into it, there's a great column that Matt Carlin's actually does around the indies, and it's a great multimedia presentation because everybody's tweeting videos and pics and everything from around the area, and it's a great spot to kind of dive in and get a little bit of visual representation of the alternatives out there that maybe you're not catching on TV, and really from all around the world he's sticking in there. So it's really great. He collects all this stuff and puts together a nice package for you to get caught up every week. So check it out, indiewrestling.us. Sign up for the newsletter. You actually get a free IWC wrestling show, including guys like some guy named AJ Styles, Christopher Daniels, guys like that on there. So go check that out, indiewrestling.us. Okay, big news last night. Sting is going to the Hall of Fame. I don't know if I expected it this. I expected somebody more Texas, personally, going in as our big headliner. I think we'll probably fill out the rest of the kind of, can we call it a Hall of Fame undercard, I guess, when we talk about this. I guess, first of all, what do you guys think of Sting going in? Justin?
Well, I think it's very fitting. If you're following me on Twitter, a couple hours prior to the 1 o'clock afternoon announcement by WWE, you'd have already known it's Sting. So I tweeted you and I said that Sting is your safe bet based upon logic and from those who I was talking to inside of the company. It makes perfect sense right now because he's really banged up. I would not be shocked if we never see Sting wrestle again. He's pretty banged up from some of the injuries he sustained from the last match against Seth Rollins, and even dating back to the match with Triple H last Mania. Not to bury the guy, so to speak, because I'm trying to put him over here in a long-winded form. But I know that there were some comments internally about Sting in terms of, Jesus, couldn't the guy have got a tan? And was he at his best? And then this is stuff coming from people that were, very close and whatever. I mean, it's great for Sting. This is the best time. The point being, he's done what he's going to do in the ring. That's done. This allows him to be featured on main event on WrestleMania weekend. He can do Access. He can do media. He's going to do Hall of Fame. Gives him his time to shine. Lets him make a speech. And because, quite frankly, in the future, he's the most relevant to the WWE audience it's ever going to be. Every year that goes by, his relevance and his memories start to fade away again. And they got other guys: The Undertaker, The Rock, other guys that are going to occupy the main headlining spots in the future years that are going to, quite frankly, outrank Sting, whether they like that or not. So it's a good time to be in Texas, as you refer to it. I think between the Freebirds, I think the Freebirds are going to be the main Texas attraction that we will probably see finally in the Hall of Fame, and justifiably so. I think we'll get a Texas flair to it, but this is the right time for Sting, and quite frankly, maybe the only time for Sting.
Mm-hmm. Some good comments from the chat room here. If you guys are on video, we got that in the corner down there. Garza saying Sting well deserved. I was expecting Taker for the Texas connection, but Mike's got a good point. He thinks Taker's only going to go in when he decides he's done and ready for the Hall of Fame. And I think that's when he's more than over with his wrestling career personally.
Well, the other thing to remember too with the Taker Texas connection is, mm-hmm. While all of us talking here and probably much of the audience are the quote unquote, tuned in smart fans, and we're aware that Taker's from Texas and lives in Texas and et cetera, his character is not at all, connected to Texas. Obviously the American Badass character, I guess, was they built in Houston, but the Dead Man character isn't. And he's the kind of guy that obviously who's protected their character or attempted to in this day and age more than him. So I don't think Texas is a big I'm not surprised that he's not trying to draw a great, love to Texans, to make himself a headliner. If you're a fan and you're from Texas and you know that that's where he's from, then I guess that's a bonus to you. But to him, I don't think that he has any – I don't think he cares if it's Texas, if it's Minneapolis, if it's Philadelphia or wherever. I think, like you said, Sorg, he's going to go in when he's – knows that he's done otherwise, and who knows how many more years he thinks he has in him.
Mm-hmm. Bobby, we have J-Town joining us here after a break. What do you think about Sting going in? You got any fond Sting memories?
I was just going to add, what's more Texas than a born-again Christian cosplaying as the Crow? It's basically Sting's gimmick, right?
Okay, yeah.
Also a baseball aficionado.
listen. The late '90s were hard, man.
On all of us. That's my favorite Sting, though. I mean, NWO Sting is like that's. I like the old Sting, but the surfer gimmick was kind of like eh. Mm-hmm.
I didn't have the WCW pre NWO, basically, like access to watching it personally. So to me, that was the shiny thing over there in WCW. Like, he was their Hulk Hogan to me. Mm-hmm. He was the shiny character. He was the antithesis of Ultimate Warrior. That kind of actually made sense. To a young kid in the late 80s, early 90s, that was really attractive, I thought, and was deservedly so, I think, their marquee person. And if you go back, that's when the good matches happened with him too. That's when RoboCop. We don't have to. And by the way, can I have a side note? Can we get RoboCop in the celebrity wing beside him? Like, just awesome. I mean, this, if we're gonna,
it's
do
only
it,
a matter of time. It's just a matter of time.
It's only a matter of time. Why not? Why not? I think. For me, even though I didn't get to experience a lot of it, like kind of looking back, like Bleach Blonde Sting was like kind of the guy at that point. So,
as long as they pay homage to that movie they kind of made with the boat blowing up,
what?
The White Castle Fear thing.
White Castle Fear.
DDP wants you to remember that because it was awesome.
They got their say on table for three on that one. So yeah, and a lot of us then had to Google White Castle of Fear and see the tug of war of doom that happened there. So. I mean, basically, Sting, you tell him there's a party and he'll go. I don't know how great of a smart, good guy he was back then. LB, what are your thoughts on Sting going in this year?
I think it makes perfect sense. I mean, you can tell this guy's beat up. He's in bad shape. His anything that you do with Sting now is going to be diminishing returns. So putting him in the Hall of Fame is the right move. He's going to stay relevant in that way that people with WWE Legends contracts stay relevant. Mm-hmm. He's a big name, and I mean, as soon as he signed with the company, the writing was on the wall. He was going to have a few WrestleMania moments. do a couple things here and there, nothing too impressive, and then be put in the Hall of Fame and have a nice little retirement plan. That is the Legends contract. So I think it's great. You know, I was never a big WCW fan, but I did enjoy Sting. I had spicy dinner. I think it's good. I think that, hopefully this will be his like kind of last chapter to his career. And it's a nice last chapter. He's not, a victim of TNA's bullshit. And he can just kind of go gracefully now. Fingers crossed.
I don't know if we're getting trolled in the chat room, but Mad Mike says that his favorite was the TNA Joker Sting and Garza's his main event Mafia Steve Borton. So maybe they'll get some representation.
I prefer T-shirt Steve in the latter days.
I mean, I wish we could just, how many, you know, we talk about the bump card when it talks to wrestling, especially somebody who's up there in the years like Sting. How many wasted good matches of WWE we could have had because of the stuff he had in TNA? You know, do you feel like that was kind of a wasted chapter in a career like that?
Absolutely. I mean, you know, there was nothing that happened in TNA that he did that, you know, really furthered anything in his legacy, quite honestly. Let's be real.
No.
And so you look and then look at the time period, you know, WWE arguably was at, you know, its most delicate and thinnest roster, you know, around that 2011 period. You know, I mean, CM Punk popped up with the pipe bomb speech, and that kind of gave some new life to the main event scene, although it wasn't really even supposed to. You know, when you think about it, imagine if Sting had been around as Edge was slowing down and then eventually retired, and Del Rio came in, but, you know, had some momentum but didn't have some momentum. You know, Batista goes away and Bret Hart comes in for a weird swan song. You know, Sting was there. You know, it's pretty interesting to think of the potential and what he could have done in the situation there. I think the company's in a better place now than it was then, so, you know, that's nice. But certainly him going up against Triple H and then Seth Rollins is pretty cool. But I think, yeah, definitely the TNA chapter, it offers nothing to his legacy. Mm-hmm.
I have a question, though. During that time when he was in TNA, do you think WWE would have had him? Like, if he had approached them and said, hey, how about we do a little business, they wouldn't have just told him to piss off?
I absolutely think that he would have, that they would have took him, yes. From everything I've, you know, and I said this on my radio show today, Sting's one of the few guys that I was unfortunately, and I hope this changes, you know, but unfortunately he's one of the few guys I never interviewed and never met personally. But from everything I've heard from people that were around him and then people that are on the WWE side, WWE's been, I mean, there's a reason why Sting versus Ric Flair was the last match on the last Nitro. That was a Vince McMahon call.
Justin,
there was never any problem with Vince's or WWE's end. Sting, it was always Sting, you know, as we've heard with WWE in terms of, you know, their content, you know, Sting was worried about how he'd be used and such and such. So, absolutely, I think, I'm sure WWE probably inquired several times whenever contracts came close to end with TNA of saying, let's try to get this guy. And he continued to resist and he stayed loyal to TNA, which says something about who he is as a person. I absolutely think WWE would have took him in a heartbeat and he would have, and it was all up to him.
I think the Shockmaster invaded partially into what you were telling us there. But we got the most of it there. We got a little bit of weird feedback going on in the middle of it. So, mostly it was him staying away, right? I was dealing technical sides here. I think it was Sting's call to stay away because he was worried about it. I think there was a statement. I was just rereading something. I heard this before, but like that whole Rock Booker T, who are you? Incident back when the early WCW invasion was felt like a sign of things to come when it came to if he came over to WWE, WWF, maybe at the time, that early on. So, I agree, you know, good that he waited, but I think he waited too long. think you waited way too long. But yeah, it is what it is. Who do you think, looking to the rest of it, RoboCop aside, who do you think rounds out the rest of Hall of Fame? We have a few suggestions from the chat room, some stuff being thrown around like the Freebirds, for instance, and JBL could be thrown in there. I think it's worthwhile for that, at least like kind of maybe the lower tier, definitely not a headliner for anything. But that can have, do a lot of Texas flavor for it. What do you think, Bobby?
I want to see Tatanka in.
Does that make sense?
He's one of the like fringe superstars I want to see in.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, he kind of goes in like a Coco Beware level, right?
No.
No?
Tatanka was better than that. I wore my tape player out playing his theme song.
Listen. Okay, wait. You wore your tape player out doing his theme song. But how many kids about 5 years older than you wore out the Power Driver album
with
Coco Beware? So I think it's all about context, Bobby. So
that's true.
So okay. We'll take that then. I mean, Lemmy seems like an obvious choice with the recent events, unfortunately, right? Who else is in your mind, LB?
That's a great question. I don't think I have an answer for it. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, it's so hard for me to keep track as to who's in and who's not anymore. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So I really don't know.
Mm-hmm. What about you, Justin?
Well, first off, if Bobby played Tatanka on his Walkman, I feel bad for that Walkman. But I would go on to say, let's not remix it at all. I would go on to say that the Freebirds obviously make complete sense given it's WCCW territory. Lemmy, in my same tweet that I told everybody Sting, before it was announced, I said Lemmy seems like a very obvious choice for the celebrity wing, which is interesting. Not to say that he doesn't deserve it, because he did, he did perform some of the greatest theme music ever. Mm-hmm. But I do feel a little bit bad that if Lemmy goes in first before Jim Johnston, who has been the maestro of almost, 30 years of WWE music, but that's another debate. I think I've heard this, and this makes complete sense. Stan Hansen, who was big in Japan, but Stan Hansen also had a Texas history, if I do believe so. So I think you go in that. I think you go in that route. I think between the Freebirds, Sting, Lemmy, given the time value, and then that he's on everybody's mind. I think you got a decent start there. There's still the Owen Hart factor. Mm-hmm. A lot of people keep saying they want Owen Hart to be a headliner, and while I'm not trying to, disrespect Owen, I don't know if we'll ever get that because of all the legality situation we hear about with his wife and the family. And obviously Owen's not alive to make a speech. And the only person that can make a speech for him would be Brett. But then you think Brett's the guy that should induct him. So I think the Owen thing is kind of a weird situation. Eventually it should happen, but I think you need to get more people on board until it does.
We have some good suggestions and some bad suggestions, Virgil.
What about Vader?
What about Vader? Vader is one that's coming up here. Bigelow, Jacqueline.
I actually hadn't considered Vader. That's a pretty good idea.
Vader, I think, is deservingly so.
Well, Vader teased on, I think, Twitter. He tweeted a picture of the Hall of Fame logo, kind of suggesting. But then again, if you know the guy behind the mask, you can't put it past the guy. He's just completely trolling all of us. So.
Yeah. Well, I haven't seen what his Twitter's like. I couldn't imagine. Teddy Long is brought up. I like that idea. I think he's overdue for something like that. Sable was brought up, being from Texas, apparently.
She's a grandma now.
What's that?
Wait, she's a grandma now.
She's a grandma. Grandma Sable can get in there.
Did they put JBL in yet?
No,
I don't think so. No. So
I could see that.
Yeah.
Rick Mall Martell.
I don't know if it feels like slim pickings. It's just there's so many out there. Mm-hmm. That are part of the Hall of Fame, it's kind of like, well, who's left?
You know? Got it. Nails.
Nails?
No. Nails. Oh, God.
Oh, it's a big boss man in. I know we're talking Cobb County, Georgia, and not Texas, but, I think he's deserved to be in there. At least he was a big part of He was a big part of my wrestling childhood, right beside Polka Dot Dusty Rhodes. So
have they ever put Kerry Von Erich, the Texas Tornado, and the Von Erich family in?
They
built Dallas, so
for some reason I presume they were already in there, but I could be wrong. Like the Von Erich family, because haven't they done like families before, to some extent?
Yeah, I think so.
Like I don't know. That was in the back of my head too. But you know, even though they're the subject of this very depressing DVD that I swear I'm going to give away at the 10-year party this Thursday at Looking for Group. That's how I get my plug in. Yeah.
It's... Well, another one is Bruiser Brody.
Oh, yeah. That'd be a good one. Good one. And that makes sense. You have Sting brings all the people in that, like, oh, we've seen Sting in the last year and a half. That's more prevalent. He's a little bigger. And then we just kind of stick in all those guys and educate, you know, the mass. And, hey, and then there's this guy. He's not the guy you're coming for, but, man, you're probably going to like or be confused by these old-timey stories, and this is why he was
like
important.
Or be confused by.
the Von Erichs were inducted in 2009.
That's why I thought. I thought they were in there. So, and it was like the family, right?
Yeah, it was the family. Yeah.
Okay. I mean, that's cool. That's cool. So that's pretty taken care of there, unless they're going to single anybody out. And I don't know. I don't know who you would single out if that was the case for that. What the Funks? Are the Funks all in?
I think they're in as a tag team, aren't they?
The Funk Brothers are in. So I think that, yeah, they're covered there. Unless we do anything individual with Terry or something like that. So I think there's a lot of options. It'll be interesting to see what kind of comes out of there. I like the idea of Vader and Lemmy to round out the top of it. Booker T's in there, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, I mean, that really does kind of round out. And Nails. So we'll look out for Nails and Virgil can get their own special one. Thanks, Bobby. So let us know, just as the chat room is, Dennis Stamp, the heart and soul of Texas from Tragar.
Nathan Jones.
Thank you. I was trying to remember the other guy. He can go in the Nails wing.
If Dennis Stamp goes in, I demand that he do his entire speech on trampoline.
Well, it'll be the Hall of Fame for the ages. All right. Well, hey, we don't have a Hall of Fame here in Beachview, but we do have some pretty famous pizza here. Slice on Broadway. They're supporting the show, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza here for nearly 2 years. Thank you so much, Fiend, whenever we have our in-studio guests. They fed everybody that was here for that insane, insane night we had for the 500 and 100 episode celebration here before Christmas. Apparently a night that I'm going to relive coming up here as I watch the Indie Mayhem Show 100 for the very first time, because I don't remember much of it, and it's out there on the internet. I'm told that the sexy, talented dudes have each watched it multiple times, so thank you for the hits, guys. And there's still unmentionable gifts that vibrate, unfortunately, that they gave me. Well, there it goes. I don't know if you can hear that. I'm not showing that one on camera. There's that. But sliceonbroadway.com. This is supposed to be a pizza commercial. I forgot. check them out. They're down here on the tracks in Beachview if you're in the South Hills of Pittsburgh, or if you're out there in Carnegie, PA. The exit's open. Go say hi to them. Tell them you heard about them on the Wrestling Mayhem Show, or have your own impromptu pizza party for Tuesday nights like Wheels does down in California, PA. He at least supports Pittsburgh Podcast. He supports Area Pizza, so appreciate that. That's no Domino's down there. I know we're making some people. There are people putting rings together in Austin, Texas, telling members of the show that they wish they had Slice on Broadway because they keep hearing about it every week. So thank you so much for everybody. Maybe we'll make Slice on Broadway a worldwide phenomenon through the podcast. Let them know, PGH_Slice on the Twitter, that you heard about them on here. And check out their Facebook, Slice on Broadway, and Instagrams for them as well. You'll get hungry too. We'll be right back with the big question.
Did you smell tuna?
Why, yes, I do. Let me tell you all about my beard. That's actually going to be one of your duties down here, is oiling up my beard. See, that's how I keep the cats friendly with me. Otherwise, they're going to reach in your mouth and take your teeth.
I like my teeth.
Well, then you better invest in tuna oil right away.
Where do you buy tuna oil?
Buy?
Hey guys, Wrestling Mayhem Show. Go check out a little more from that. A little bit from Sawtooth Willie over at SorgatronMedia.com. Check out the whole series on YouTube or the Facebook page. A lot of fun, and I hope you guys are enjoying Penny Avocado. There's a lot more interesting characters coming up in the coming months with that as well. And that's a lot saying in regards to Sawtooth Willie. So it's that time of the week for the big question from Papa Lunchbox. Has one for us to tickle our brain bones on pro wrestling. What you got for us, LB? Right, yeah, that went with that. I said that.
Well, Sork, a big part of this week's big question is thanks to Matt Carlins, actually.
Uh-oh.
He tweeted what this week's big question should be, and frankly, I agreed with him wholeheartedly. And Roman Reigns, asked the question, what if I win? So this week's question, this week's very big question is, what if he does win? What's the best case scenario if Roman Reigns wins the Royal Rumble? And when I say best case scenario, I don't mean best case scenario for Roman Reigns or best case scenario for Vince McMahon. I mean best case scenario for you, the person answering.
Cool. Can I don't usually, but can I go first? By
all means.
Lights go out, Undertaker points to the sign. Why not?
Dig it.
Okay. Bobby?
Like I said in the hangout last night, I want Roman Reigns to win, point at the WrestleMania sign, and then just stand in the main event all by himself and fight nobody. Just take up time. Just standing there.
Stay up there.
No. I would suggest Brock Lesnar because that's the only other person I see him fighting.
Okay.
In a rematch because they really didn't get their match because Seth Rollins came out. So I think that would be a good match.
Do you find that match more acceptable than it was last year? Going into it, because I feel like people weren't sold on that match, right?
I think he's ready now. I think now that he's had the title and he's been there and he's showing that he's getting better every week.
Yeah.
I think he's ready.
And we saw how brutal that match got. So we know kind of a starting point of what we would get, right?
Brock Lesnar like blades for everything.
Well, yeah, is that too.
He had blood on his mouth last night and he was just beating up like people.
Sorry, he goes hardcore. Justin LaBar, what do you think?
Well, I'm a fan of Roman Reigns, so the best case scenario is for Roman Reigns to fight Triple H. Brock Lesnar is not a good idea. There's a lot of people that aren't good ideas because what happens is you put Roman Reigns up against Brock Lesnar. Well, it's the same thing you saw last year, and that's the case of the crowd is going to split. They're going to take Brock Lesnar over Roman Reigns. And right now, you've got Roman Reigns on the best bit of momentum he's ever had. You need to make sure he's up against guys that the crowd loves to hate. Guys like Sheamus, which is work. Guys like Vince McMahon, even though indirectly, it's work. Triple H would work. Whether Triple H is champion or not champion, people love to hate Triple H for the character purposes and the real life purposes. That's going to ensure Roman Reigns' momentum going upwards. Most other options, not a good idea.
Awesome. Matt Carlins, he's preparing with the Mayhem Mania big board behind him, of course, with his our radio writer over at WrestlingMayhemShow.com and IndieWrestling.us. What do you think?
I'm having a hard time wrapping around my mind around the part of the question where LB says, in the best case scenario, if Roman Reigns wins, because it doesn't sound like the best idea. Like,
gotta spin it, Matt. Make it the best case scenario for you.
Look, let me spin. Roman Reigns is the guy who keeps winning is kind of like it does and it doesn't work. Like, you want the guy who kicks ass, but then you want a little bit of vulnerability, I guess. You want some sense that maybe he could be beat. When you're the audience, I think part of the resentment when it comes to Reigns is that it's the sense that he's going to win no matter what. Kind of like the same thing people kind of got into the habit of feeling whenever John Cena would be doing his thing. The best case scenario for Roman Reigns winning at the Rumble, I don't know, probably him and Lesnar at the end of the Rumble, and somebody shockingly debuting or arriving on the scene to screw over Brock Lesnar. So Roman Reigns still wins. So Reigns wins, and Lesnar comes out of the Rumble with some absolute blood feud with somebody. So pick your guy, whoever you want to drag into that mess. We can do AJ Styles. We could do Finn and the Bullet Club show up and screw Lesnar. We could do any of those things. We could have the Drifter show up and screw Brock Lesnar. We could do that. LaBar's shaking his head at me, so I know my answer's good.
You take, the problem is all that takes a focus away from Roman Reigns. Again, you let Roman Reigns – have we not learned anything about Daniel Bryan being involved and not being involved in Rumbles, which is you got to make sure that Roman Reigns comes down to the end with people that the audience despises. And if you put him down with Brock Lesnar, even if Brock Lesnar gets screwed by, again, whomever – and it's not going to be the whole Bullet Club. AJ Styles is the only one that you're going to be able to contractually see anyways at Royal Rumble. If you put him down with Brock Lesnar and Brock Lesnar gets screwed, even if he gets screwed by Bray Wyatt or Kevin Owens, it's just people are going to be like, oh, damn, I wanted that. And they're going to resent Roman Reigns, which is not what you want to do after you're finally getting succession. If Roman Reigns is going to go down to the end of it, which you got to think he is since he's the champion, really, Triple H is the only guy that I can think that's going to make sense because there's business to be finished and people love to hate Triple H. Yeah.
So if we're coming down to a situation where it's Reigns, a lot of people think it might be Triple H. How do you get Lesnar out of that match without it just looking bad for him?
You simply have – first off, it's got to be early in the match. You have Lesnar early in the match, and I'm not – specific number I'm not dialed in on. But as long as it's early in the match – if you have Lesnar, I think the best thing in my mind, Lesnar eliminates whoever it is that he's going to have a WrestleMania match with. Kevin Owens has been an internet fantasy. Bray Wyatt's been another internet fantasy. Whomever. Let Brock Lesnar eliminate whoever that person is. And let that person, whether they do it right away, whether they come back minutes later, let that person come back with numbers. If it's the Wyatt family, if it's Bray Wyatt, it'd be the Wyatt family. If it's Kevin Owens, it'd be him grabbing a chair. Let that person come back with some kind of a crazy advantage and just beat the holy living you-know-what out of Brock Lesnar and make an impact for themselves and give everybody a reason to why they want to see this match happen. That's how you get Brock Lesnar out of the match. But it has to be earlier because if he comes down to the final four with Roman Reigns, again, you're going to be pitting people against Roman Reigns whether you intend to or not.
But just to play devil's advocate, with respect, because I do enjoy listening to your opinions, isn't that the same mistake they made last year with Daniel Bryan? Isn't that what they tried to do with Daniel Bryan last year?
No.
They tried to get Bryan out of the Rumble early, and it ended up turning twisted on him.
No, what they did last year was they got Daniel Bryan out of the Rumble because they wanted to keep him away from Roman Reigns when the whole thing is they should never put Daniel Bryan in the Rumble in the first place. You shouldn't. The fact is, last year that everybody was waiting for Daniel Bryan to come back after he'd been injured for 9 months, after having to, vacate his world title. They should have never brought Daniel Bryan back for the Rumble. They should have waited till the night after Rumble. They should have waited till a week after Rumble, and there would have not nearly been as much backlash against Roman Reigns as there were because they brought Bryan back. Everybody, especially in the Philadelphia crowd, goes, "Oh my God, Daniel Bryan's got to win. He left off as world champion. He never got beat for it." And then when he got injured early because they wanted to keep him out of the picture, people resented it. This is a different case. Brock Lesnar, you get him eliminated by a guy who's already been eliminated. Again, Bray Wyatt, Kevin Owens, insert whoever. And by a guy who does some dastardly act. Maybe the guy even knocks out Paul Heyman, whatever. You do that, then everybody rallies behind Brock Lesnar. There's that story. But you do it early enough, they can still focus on Roman Reigns and however you finish things. And the same thing is applied this year. I'm hoping to have an interview with Daniel Bryan in the next 2 weeks. And the case is this. You can't have Daniel Bryan in the Rumble because if you have him in the Rumble, that distracts everybody. And if he doesn't win it, which he's not going to win it, he's never going to be world champion again, then all of a sudden everybody's pissed off about it. So it's not the same situation. I know what you're saying, but it's not the same situation.
Yeah, I gotcha. Yeah, and just to piggyback off what you said about, you can't have Bryan in the Rumble. You can't even have the suggestion of Bryan possibly maybe showing up at the Rumble. And he's been doing, a lot of a lot of social media kind of turning the screws a little bit. And to me, I'm like, this is not a good idea. You're getting people's hopes up again. You're feeding that monster all over again.
Absolutely. If they have any inclination in inquiring to show Dan O'Brien on January 24th, they better show him via satellite over in Syria trying to talk down ISIS, because if you have Orlando, there's going to be a problem.
Wow. I can't top that. Chat room's having a lot of fun with this. What about an old-fashioned Royal Rumble tie? I don't know about that. You know, maybe Rumble Reigns. We got the head shake from LaBar. No way.
Well, but the problem I have with the tie thing, and somebody called every Tuesday at 2 o'clock on Triple I Radio. Please check it out. The problem I have with the Bret Hart Lex Luger 1994 finish, as we'll call it, the difference was, and the difference also was with the 92 Ric Flair, the world, Roman Reigns is the world champion, and he's going to this Rumble.
Right.
In 92, the title was vacated, mm-hmm. so it was open for whomever. In 94, Luger and Hart had a draw, and it was like, okay, you both have the draw, you're going to face Yokozuna. You know, I can't imagine WWE starting the road to WrestleMania with a title vacated, much less being vacated from the guy who they put so much effort into trying to get over, and they finally have gotten him over, or at least it's working so far. So if you do any kind of a draw tie finish, it does no favors. Again, I mean, I'm not trying to sound like a Roman Reigns apologist. I like him. He's not my favorite guy, but I do, you know, but I'm going back to the fact of, if Roman Reigns is their project, which obviously he is, and it's finally working, it does no favors to have him tie with anybody. He either needs to overcome the odds, I suppose, or it needs to be a guy like Triple H, again, somebody who he has business to finish with, who everybody hates, and he has a reason to chase. And then you can dress it up, as I said earlier in the show, dress it up with Triple H, with Stephanie McMahon and Vince in his corner, versus Roman Reigns with The Rock and Ronda Rousey in his corner. That makes a sexy marquee match that people want to see Roman Reigns win with. But if you do a tie, again, we've never had the world champion go into this. A tie is not going to be a good thing for Roman Reigns.
No. All right, let us know what you think of the big question, hashtag WMS big question, if you're looking for us on Twitter or if you're on this video. We put a short version of this out all over on the Facebook and the YouTube. So let us know your thoughts as well. So with that, hey, we are bringing back an old concept. It is the Mayhem Mania, a game we did on the back end of the show here in the lead up. I think we started a lot later than we are currently. But this led to a lot of controversy last year. Some
hurt feelings,
some friendships were ended, and
I think Mike and Riz stopped talking to each other for a little bit.
Yeah. So
I had a lunchbox with a chair.
It got pretty violent. It got pretty weird for a little bit there. So it seems like the right time to bring it back here before Rumble. Matt, you're saying, you know, you just wrote about it, and we've been talking about the perfect time because it's so up in the air with everything going on right now.
Everything's all crazy, Sorg. So we're going to bring this back, and I'm glad Justin's here because we need someone who has no knowledge of what in the hell this is so we could try to explain it to him. So I'm kind of hoping you guys are going to help me out.
All right, you are our guinea pig.
Okay. I'm kind of going back to the final write-up we did on Mayhem Mania last year. So we're going to actually put one in the Slack doc if you want to pull this up.
Ooh,
if you
want
to show people the 8-match supercard that we ended up with, which was pretty good. But basically, Mayhem Mania is kind of a competitive thought experiment. The object basically is to create the best WrestleMania card possible, not necessarily to predict what WWE is going to do. We're trying to create something even better. So we're trying to come up with 8 matches. And for these first couple rounds, basically the 4 of you are going to get to conjure up any match you can pick out of your little brain out of thin air. And then next week we'll bring back 4 guys and they will conjure up another 4 matches, and then we'll have the 8-match card, and then things really get fun because then we'll get to bring guys in and they'll get to make changes that they want to make to the card. So if they don't like something, they'll be able to throw something out. And basically matches that survive for a certain amount of time, maybe 2 or 3 weeks. I think 3 weeks is what we went with last year. If your match survives untarnished, unaltered for 3 weeks, it graduates to the supercard. And basically, we're trying to fill out the 8-match supercard. So that's kind of loosely how the game works. I'm sure it's confusing. I'm coming at you real fast and furious. Another thing I got to point out is that when we're creating these matches, we are creating these in the real world. We are not we can't break the laws of this wrestling world that we live in here today. So this isn't fantasy booking. Justin, this is reality booking. Huh? If you wanted to say,
you're telling me the Ultimate Warrior can't come back from the dead.
No.
Exactly. We cannot bring the Ultimate Warrior back from the dead. If Bobby once said, I want to see Beer Money versus the New Day, then we got to be like, I'm sorry, Bobby, but Beer Money's under contract to TNA. They ain't coming.
Now there's going to be a whole
lot of other kinds that you could pick from. To do something like that. So
you know how I love my Beer Money.
Don't we all?
No.
You could create a tag match. You could create a 3-way, 4-way. Don't create a battle royal. That ruins it for everybody. So
everyone.
Everybody. No one versus all matches. I'm putting my foot down at that. If it feels like one of you has crossed the line, someone's going to speak up. So let's see how we can pull this off. LB, I know you've got somewhere to be. So is there anything you would like to create?
Well, I guess there is. Now, last year I had a baby of a match. I had a match that I cared about, and I commissioned other people to take care of it for me, and they fucked me in the asshole repeatedly until my match no longer existed. Not holding a grudge, not mentioning any names, but go fuck yourself. So I'm going to go out in left field. I'm not gonna pick a match that I'm emotionally invested in, because this is the first round of Mayhem Mania. We're gonna do this a little differently and be a little smarter about it. Because I know, by the time in a couple of weeks, this match will no longer exist, or it'll be in some fucking format that I don't even recognize, or it'll be a ladder throw sling around mud pie match. So, well, here's what we're gonna have. All right. So
such a positive way to
show
start
your
this.
Hand in the first week. That's a good strategy.
Exactly. If you're at work and you got the white elephant, you don't take the Amazon gift card right away. You take the shitty candle, knowing you're going to get the Amazon gift card later. So
that's how you do it.
This is how you do it. So first match on the WrestleMania card. We're going to keep this real simple. We're going to have the New Day, all three of them, versus. You should be writing this down. Are you writing this down?
Please pardon my handwriting. Go on, LB.
Let's see here. We're going to have the New Day, and they're going to be facing.
Okay. All three.
All three of the New Day.
You didn't think this through, did you?
I didn't. I didn't come up with another tag team. I was going to say the Lucha Dragons, but who would their third be? Who would the third person in the Lucha Dragons
be? If only there was someone else Mexican under WWE contract for us to put in that match with them. What?
That's racist.
That's branding.
Something. They don't all have to be in the same match.
That's branding. Okay, let's have – I'll tell you what. This is just a – main roster guys. Can we bring up people from NXT?
Sure you can.
Yay. How about Intergroup?
Anything within the realm of reality. How about no conjuring up dead people and no bringing back wrestlers who will never come back.
I want to point out, I'm looking at last year's card, and there's a lot of people.
Injuries count. This is real time right now.
There's a lot of people on this card last year that are still in NXT. So, like, a lot of people. So
yeah, we went wild.
Throw that in
so
there.
We can bring up from NXT, but we can't use injured superstars.
You can't use a currently injured guy. You got to bring up a guy who will actually show up at the show.
Okay.
I got it, and I'm really excited about this. This is a match I would actually like to see. We got the New Day, right? Minus Xavier Woods. We're going to pull him right out of there because it's going to be a 2-on-2 versus Enzo and Cass.
Okay.
And for 10 minutes before the match, it's just them talking to each other
on the mic.
Nice.
Just having a conversation, being bonkers.
In a rap battle match.
In a rap battle. That's what I would like to see.
There you go. The first
match. I hear Big Cass has a lovely voice.
So. Yes.
Oof. Okay.
So with that, I'm gonna boogie on out of here, folks. Have a good Mayhem Mania, and everyone at home, check out Panel Riot, panelriot.com. We have a new episode up this very week. Do you like Battlestar Galactica? Well, why?
What?
All right.
All right. Thank you. I'll be DJ Lunchbox on Twitter. Holy
thanks,
crap!
Bye, guys.
Later,
but anyways, who do you want to go next here? Bobby?
Let's go to Bobby next.
Let's go to Bobby. Bobby, what do you got?
Yeah, you next, Bob.
All right. Well, I about had a heart attack because I thought Will was going to take one of my people. I'm going to go with the United States champion, Kalisto. Versus... Oh, shit, he's injured.
it's a long list right now.
You didn't think this through, did you?
He's coming back soon, if that has any indication. I'm going to go with NXT superstar Sami Zayn. He just came back.
Okay.
I get the feeling you've got more guys coming.
Right. Yeah. Versus Neville in a three-way dance.
There you go.
Okay. Okay. That's your fun match of the night.
Flippy guys.
That's your flippy guy match. Okay. All right.
It's here for those flippy guys.
I can see that. I can see that.
Flippy guys.
Sorg, I want you to go next.
Okay. Okay. Let me go. Let's go and throw down Kevin Owens. I think it's a pretty safe bet here. We want him in there. I don't want to go something safe like Dean Ambrose. I think that's going to fizzle out. Whatever's going to happen there before WrestleMania is no way. It's already been going for a little bit. So it's got to be something else interesting. Not a Dolph Ziggler. That's not very exciting. As far as somebody else that can come back, I want somebody Stone Cold like, but not really. Maybe. Do you think he could have a good match with Jericho? Like, I don't know. Like, I feel like I want to throw him against Jericho, but I want Jericho that I watched from 2008, and not maybe.
Well, fortunately, that is within the realm of possibility. So if
we
want suit-wearing Jericho, you can have suit-wearing Jericho.
Oh, in my mind, yeah, he comes back. I know it doesn't make sense unless Owens kind of turns face in this regard. You know, honestly, if Jericho came back with a suit, he'd pretty much be a face anyways, right? At this point, like, it's like, Ric Flair doing a dirty tactic does not make him a heel at this point, right? Yeah, I want to have weird amalgam Jericho in the suit, but we like him. Let's do it. And in my mind, this is like 2005, 2008 Chris Jericho, and this is a barn burner match. And this is, everybody's been down on Jericho for these weird matches he's been having, although he had a classic against Neville.
Amen, who shall remain nameless.
Amen is a very, but he didn't grow up. He was like two when Jerkaholism was a addictive thing that the country was dealing with.
12-step program.
I think it was on the back of my shirt I bought back then. So Jericho pops up, shows he can still go in an awesome match with Kevin Owens, completely brutal. That's what I got.
So Jericho, will he wrestle in the suit?
No,
like a
that's weird.
So it'll be suit versus shorts and t-shirt.
This is like the ultimate battle.
Side booking, and I hope you can find me a picture of this. He goes back to the long tights.
Oh, that'd be lovely.
That's the real coup right there.
All right, Justin.
Well, if we're staying in realm of possibility, but we're going fantasy, I'm going to go with AJ Styles versus Daniel Bryan. A simple marquee grudge match.
I like it.
WWE can just let these two guys let the internet jack off and let it go. It would be that, because Dan O'Brien's not going to be in any more world title matches because it's too much of a risk to WWE, like it or not. And the entire Bullet Club is not going to all be together, I don't think, at that point. And they might not even go that route. So I just think you just have a simple jack off match of AJ Styles versus Dan O'Brien. And I want you to mark it down, Matt, as a jack off match.
Jack off match? Is that a stipulation?
That's a stipulation.
It is.
whatever person in the match ejaculates quicker, or whatever fan representative in the crowd ejaculates quicker, comes into the stipulation.
It's your jack off.
Was there a match like that from Vince Russo?
Maybe so, maybe so, but I'm taking full credit of it because
it's the jack off WrestleMania match brought to you by Chair Shot Reality.
Exactly.
I would be tempted to call shenanigans on putting Daniel Bryan in here, but I know that you know things, so I'm going to let this one go.
What is? I don't know the latest. What is the, like? Is it all but confirmed? AJ's in there within the next couple weeks.
AJ, I encourage everybody here and your listeners to use WrestleRumble.com, where you can, bet. You can put in $10 and predict the outcomes, and in this case, predict who comes in at exactly what position 1 through 30 of Rumble. The winner wins $500, and there's prizes beyond that. I would say it is in the words of Vince McMahon, it's guarantee AJ Styles will be one of the 30 guys. Now, what number? That's where you have to get creative. But AJ Styles is going to be, he's the only guy that you can see because he's not working the contract. He's ready to go. Gallows, right. Who I love personally, him and Anderson, you're going to see soon, but I think you're going to see him in NXT first. Nakamura, granted, he's getting out of his New Japan stuff. He still needs to move over here. He still needs a work visa. He also needs to be hyped. They understand they cannot let him debut cold,
right?
Because there's a lot of people in WWE audience, the younger fans, that don't know who the hell he is. So they have to do the Sin Cara route, and they need to show hype videos and build him up. I think he's a prime guy for the night after Mania, so to speak. But AJ Styles is the one guy you have to play with in this fantasy booking lead to Mania. And if Daniel Bryan's healthy enough by Mania and they want to use him, you don't put him in a title match. But if you still want to appease Bryan and still want to appease the audience, you put him in a marquee jack-off match.
Wrestling turn.
Awesome.
I wish I could make that the title of this show. Marquee jack-off match. But I considering it's right next to like mindfulness podcast, I can't do that. All right. The
be
first
mindful of how you jack off.
A review. What does the first half of WrestleMania look like, Matt?
Oh yes, thank you very much, Sork. It's gonna be the New Day, Kofi and the Big E versus Enzo and Cass. It's gonna be Kalisto versus Sami Zayn versus Adrian Neville. It's going to be Kevin Owens versus Chris Jericho in a suit, and it will be the marquee jack-off match presented by Chair Shot Reality, AJ Styles versus Daniel Bryan.
I have a feeling that's not going to last long.
four more fellas will land four more matches onto this 8-match card, and then the fun will begin. Then the tampering begins, the hurt feelings begins. And we'll see if one of these matches can make it to the very end. I like the chances of some of these. These are good.
I think it's a good start. I think it's a very strong start. I feel good about that. All right. Well, we'll stay tuned on there. Mayhem Mania, there will be updates. And you're still doing a weekly update on that. You're going to do a write-up.
I'm working on it as we speak.
You're working as with his other hand, he's typing a blog right now. Remember, long pants Jericho picture. Long pants Jericho picture. All right.
Long pants Jericho in a suit picture.
It's the back of the book. It's the end of the show. Let me know, what did you learn from wrestling this week? And I know we got a couple from out there in the social media as well, so we'll poke at them. Let me know in the chat room as well, what did you learn from wrestling this week? Bobby, what do you got?
I learned that I got irrationally sad. I watched New Year's Dash, and Taguchi shaved his mustache. He's Japanese Eddie Guerrero. We can't do that. That's what I learned this week.
You said something about a mustache and Japanese Eddie Guerrero. I don't think I comprehended anything else you just told me.
Taguchi. The Funky Weapon.
Oh, the Funky Weapon. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. I saw your angry tweets about that. Still didn't understand
them. He shaved his mustache. What the hell, dude?
It's all about branding. Maybe it's like how WWE used to make everybody cut their hair when they came in. Yeah, could be something like that. Justin LaBar, what did you learn from wrestling this week?
I learned that my love and attraction for Stephanie McMahon only grew when I saw her fetishly dancing with her father, and I was turned on.
it was take your daughter to work and make her dance the weird poses with you night on Raw.
And I'm in no way upset about that.
Ric Flair and Charlotte, Vince McMahon and Stephanie. They took that kid from the crowd, Titus Young. Titus O'Neil.
Just combine them. Just combine them. He stole somebody's kid, and then he got taken out. I mean,
and the kid was like no selling. I'm like, yeah.
Kid's not even in wrestling. Matt Carlins, what'd you learn from wrestling this week?
Oh God, I learned so much. It's just hard to compartmentalize everything. I learned that it's nearly impossible for Paul Heyman and Stephanie McMahon to end a conversation without having the last word. I don't know if you guys noticed that in that backstage segment they did on Raw where they were like, okay, I'll do that. Okay, you do that. Okay, I will. All right.
They didn't talk about the finish to that one, huh? From the chat room, Mad Mike learned that Tito Santana has a Mexican restaurant in Beacon, New York, which is apparently not very far from Poughkeepsie, where he resides. I wonder if the folks over from another wrestling podcast know about that as well. Wheels learned that he couldn't take the rest of Raw last night. Wheels tapped out before the beginning of hour two, he said. When he joined us last night.
The last hour was the best.
It was the best. It felt like everything was kind of mushed together, but I don't know. It's just, you know, I just had too much coffee at that point to try to stay awake through it. But yeah, I'm kind of with him on that. From the Facebook, Kiko in there says the vacant is the most decorated wrestler in the history of wrestling. This must be in regards to Nakamura's title.
That's true.
Drop there.
Fact.
I mean, he's had the IWGP. Is it IWGP Intercontinental or?
Yep.
Okay. He's had that. He's had the TNA title. He's had that. He was a co-holder of the TNA and the WWE title. So. That's pretty significant. He should be a Hall. When does Bacon get in the Hall of Fame? Can we get that in Texas?
Sure. Can I chime in with one more thing? I just thought of something else here real quick. I learned that I learned from wrestling this week that a subscription to New Japan World is one of the finest things you can share with your friends.
You're welcome. Thanks,
man. You're welcome. There you go. What did I learn from wrestling this week? I learned... Yeah, I'm blanking. I love SmackDown with no commercials. I don't know why. There's something. It's the first week I got to do it in a few weeks, but I love my Sunday morning SmackDown like with a coffee and a pastry, and just watching it and shutting off Twitter. There's something about that I think is the best way to watch wrestling right now with no judgments, no expectations. And I know I'm sounding like one of our other podcasts, but I don't know. I recommend it, and I think you get out of mainstay WWE. I think you get the best matches, and the best, you know, nice. If you know how we went to NXT and we're like, oh, it's nice, it's an hour, and we're done, right? It's kind of nice to just get out of there. SmackDown feels that way now, thanks to Raw.
Ronaldo makes you care about SmackDown, and after 1 week.
Oh yeah, that new announcer.
Yeah,
and I remember he did MMA before, right?
And boxing?
MMA and boxing?
He was calling Mayweather fights.
Okay, because he sounded familiar, and it did kind of give that kind of bigger feel to it. I think that's a nice add to that, and I hope that kind of ups the game there. I think so he's got Byron and Lawler on there, so I think it'll take a few weeks to kind of see how that mixes together.
Why is Byron Saxon on both shows?
Yeah, Byron.
Out of everybody.
I don't
because
get
you need a black guy.
Oh.
That's true.
On Booker's busy.
It's Corey Graves up in there.
Well, I'll also say with Mauro Ranallo, if we all did not need another reason to love Renee Young, and last night I tweeted during Raw that I like Mauro. I thought he did great on SmackDown, and I said if you needed any more reason to like Renee Young, I've been hearing that she gave a valuable endorsement to the powers to be, which helped convince them to sign Mauro. And about 2 minutes later, he retweeted it and then quoted it and said, "This is true." #OCanada. Right. So more praise to Renee Young. If you needed more reason to love her, is that she helped get a guy who's not normally a Vince guy on commentary. Although I'm not going to get too excited about Mauro because he's on SmackDown. Vince is not at SmackDown anymore. Road Dogg is running the SmackDown shows. I'd be very weary to hear the first time Vince is on the headset on the opposite side of the curtain from Mauro, what kind of train wreck could come of that? Oh. But we'll wait and see.
We'll see. I mean, you could tell he was still kind of growing into it a little bit. But damn, he beats Mike Adamly right off the bat. So
Jeff Harvey.
Jeff Harvey. Guys, it's been the Wrestling Mayhem Show. Thank you so much. Justin LaBar, Chair Shot Reality, thank you for joining us on the show tonight.
Thanks, guys, for having me. This was fun. I appreciate it.
What's you're many, 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 many places. It starts with CSRWrestling.com, of course. But where can people check out if they're digging your opinions tonight and want to hear more?
I'm kind of like the Donald Trump of wrestling coverage. People either love me, hate me. They're sick of me everywhere. I would just say follow me on Twitter. Look for the blue check mark every single day, whether it's Monday, Friday, trip columns, Tuesday, radio, weekend, Chair Shot Reality, special appearances on such shows as this. I would just say follow my Twitter, look for the blue check mark, and you'll have more than you know what to do with of me each week.
That is true. He is all over the multiple medias all the time. I'm always seeing something pop up from there. I try to catch up and get some tweeted over on Mayhem Show. I'm really bad at that lately.
I'm still waiting for Sword to create the Justin LaBar app to make my work more efficient for everybody else. So please get on it.
There you go. There you go. Have it filtered through. I know some people. We can talk. Mainstream Matt Carlin's our friend. The man who's interviewed.
We're good, thanks.
The other guy on the show that's interviewed the stars over there.
One or two.
One or two of them. And did not get beat up by Cesaro, so that was good. Mainstream Matt on the Twitters. He writes the columns over at WrestlingMayhemShow.com, IndieWrestling.us. A great one today about, you know, that we kind of started off with the germ of an idea for the first segment. What do you got in the pipeline coming up that we can look forward to?
More around the indies. At some point, there's going to have to be a Wrestler of the Year column. I think that's coming very soon. It might come by the end of the week. We'll see.
Awesome. Oh, and we've got...
If I don't write it soon, it'll be too late. So, got to act on it.
Almost forgot. We got to plug something else. But first, Bob, you have JTown on InsertCoinToBegin.com.
Yeah, and I might be on at midnight tonight. My tweet. Pray for me. I doubt it's going to be. But I was in the top 10 last night.
Oh, work on that confidence, Bobby. It is definitely going to be. You're a funny son of a bitch. And go follow him at Bobby F. JTown. He's got good stuff over there. Hey, shouts out. We're going to be starting next week, posting probably after Wrestling Mayhem Show 503. We got the Mayhemmies are going to start to be rolled out. We had an expert panel. Sorry, LaBar, your card got lost in the mail. Justin Plummer, Joe Dabrowski, and Chris LaRusso joining us, helping us pick some of the selections of the best wrestlers and moments and everything of the year. And we'll be rolling those out here and getting.
Well, your budget really fell short for the B team, huh?
It was a little rough. It was a little rough. But anyways, we had a great discussion with that, and that'll be rolling out very, very soon. Also, if you're in the Pittsburgh area this Thursday at Looking for Group in Brookline, in the South Hills of Pittsburgh here, still in the Pittsburgh city limits, actually, a great video game place down there. For free, we're covering the cost. You can come out, hang out, play some Xbox, play some PlayStation, play some computers. They have an Oculus Rift VR helmet. I got to play with that last time I was in there. And I will be viewing for the first time Indie Mayhem Show 100. No, I didn't watch that yet. No, I don't remember much of that. No, I don't remember where a lot of this stuff came from. And apparently I'm going to discover what that's about there. We're going to have fun with that. There are party favors. I have not looked at them, but the party planners have this in the back of the car. I saw a Daniel Bryan skateboard fall out of it, and I can't imagine what else they got. So there'll be goodies. There'll be fun. And we'll be celebrating 10 years of this silly little podcast that has everybody from all over the place. I'm hanging out and talking wrestling on Tuesday nights. So thank you so much for joining us live at WrestlingMayhemShow.com, 9 p.m. Eastern Time every Tuesday night. WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Find all the links to subscribe, Patreon. Thank you so much to our supporters. And thank you so much to everybody out there. Follow us throughout the week. Let us know your thoughts on everything we talked about in this show and all the other shows. Mayhem app. Just wait. Just wait. Just wait. Just wait. Just wait. Wait for the perfect time. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.